Okay, welcome to the planning board meeting for Monday, November 16th, 2015. Thank you, HCAM, for recording the meeting. We're short a couple of members, and that's always helpful so that they can review the tape and be able to vote on any continued public hearings. For the agenda tonight, we've got the library up first. Our 8 o'clock hearing for 34 to 40 Hayden Rowe Street will be continued probably to December 7th. So if you're here for that, go home and have another adult beverage. Our 8:30 continued public hearing application for the Hopkinton Tennis Club will also make an interesting meeting. Well, other key points besides some of the normal stuff we're doing is we will discuss the Rafferty Road sidewalk sometimes today, probably at 8 o'clock or so. So let's get started with continued public hearing. We have six members that are able to vote tonight, and we need six to approve a parking permit. So and this is one copy that the town manager has given us.
Oh,
so that
sharing.
We are sharing it. So anyway, let's open the continued public hearing for 13 Main Street and 9 Church Street. This is site plan review application and shared off-street site parking special permit application from the town of Hopkinton. Let's go through the shared parking because, number one, we have to vote for that first in order to be in compliance with the zoning. And we also have six members here. Brian is our marginal member today, given he's not been feeling too well and made a special trip just to make sure we had six people to vote on it today. So that's why we've isolated him down there in the corner. So, okay. I guess we received a copy just a short while ago of the license agreement between the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Boston and the town of Hopkinton to allow 40 parking spaces to be used in the church parking lot for library uses. And so I'd like to open it up for discussion. Everyone has pretty well read that agreement. It does provide the parking that's needed that meets the bylaw. Is there anyone that has a problem with that or has further discussion? Yeah, go ahead.
Having just read it,
yep.
I don't think I'm even ready to vote on anything like this until I kind of digest it, because I have questions. I don't want to appear. I'm a big supporter of the library because it's part of the expansion. I probably use the library more than most.
Do you walk there or do you drive there, Frank?
I do drive there.
Okay.
So I'm a person that creates a need for parking.
Mm-hmm.
That said, I don't know if it's $16,000 per year for additional spaces. I don't know if that how that reflects to the reality of the situation.
This was negotiated between the town and the church. And
I don't mean that to sound like a criticism of the negotiation. I don't understand how that number fits in with the perception of what
I don't
pay for parking.
I don't think that we have to, the amount is anything that we care about. It's just that the number is over 23 spots, and that provides for 40. And probably if 41 go there, nobody in the church is going to count the spots. So, I mean, it's... as far as I think from the bylaw standpoint, in my opinion, it meets the requirement.
Meets the requirement of the parking spaces, which is...
Right. Well, that's all, but
right.
Whether it's a good deal or not, that's the Board of Selectmen problem.
Yeah. Well, I would like, then, in that case, I would like some input from the Board of Selectmen on that, because I don't want to, I think the Planning Board should have some foresight, and we're looking for creative ways to find parking, and we urge these guys to do this. I didn't know it was going to be this price tag with it, and it makes me feel uncomfortable.
Well, maybe, Ben, can you help out Frank here on this?
Through the chairman.
Sure.
Frank, this is a done deal. Whether you do the library or not, we're paying $16,000 a year for parking spaces. So it doesn't matter what, if you like the price or not. It's been negotiated by the town. It's agreed upon with the town. It's going to be put in place. So it should be irrelevant to your decision making. In my opinion, the only thing you're worried about is what the chairman said, which is there enough parking? The rest of it's our problem.
I hear you say about the done deal. That doesn't make me feel any better.
Because doesn't matter, Frank. This is outside your jurisdiction. Right. This is unequivocally the Board of Selectmen's decision.
Then you push me to a negative response because here's my concern. I don't know if I have enough information right now, just having read this, to understand the impact of $16,000 a year on the budget, on the town, on everything that is included with it. And if the planning board says yes to this, then for a number of spaces, that's good. But for the further impact, which we have to have some foresight on this, that have some concern. I'd just like to be able to understand it and look at it. And I just sat down 5 minutes ago, and if I'm the sixth vote, I don't mean to be a jerk about this. I like the library expansion. I want it to happen, but we have certain things we need to follow, and I don't feel comfortable voting on this right now. I just would like more information. And being told it's a done deal makes me even less happy.
Through the chair, just a question. First, I understand what Frank is saying, but it's my understanding that our vote is really just to make sure that there's enough parking for this use. That's what our jurisdiction is. And if our jurisdiction is there enough parking for this use, then this license agreement provides that parking for the use. So then it's okay to go forward from our jurisdiction. Am I right?
That is my interpretation of that, for sure. And, you know, from what I understand, the amount was based on what the church pays for snow plowing or something, and we do for Bill's parking lot behind here, we do all the snow plowing and the maintenance of
those
things.
These are things I need to have more understanding of.
And you know, we probably pay more per spot than this deal with the church.
It may or may not be a bad deal for the town, but that's not what we're here about.
Here's my point. I would like to not be able to have to vote on this today because I don't want to just have a knee-jerk vote on this from my perspective.
Claire?
Yeah. I concur with Brian. In the years that I've sat on this board, our concern is site plan, that the site plan standards have been met, and that involves lighting is appropriate, pedestrian needs are met, parking needs are met, stormwater needs are met. While we are all concerned as taxpayers about monetary issues, I really haven't seen this board have authority to enter into decisions on finances of something. I think that is outside of our jurisdiction. Concerns about the town finances would appear to be in the purview of the selectmen to make, and our purview is if the site plan now is approvable, and I believe it is. I also believe that as nice as it would be to get this for free, the St. John's Church is giving us a service of value, and they have every reason on earth to ask to be somehow compensated for that service. So I can understand where they're coming from, and I do not believe that issues of town finance fall under the planning board.
Okay.
Yeah.
The board has to make two findings to grant the special permit. And the first is that all parking spaces are associated with the use are within a practical walking distance. And the second is that the grant of the special permit will be in harmony with the general purpose and intent of the zoning bylaw. And that's it. Those are the two findings that the board needs to make. It's related to the parking and it's related to the zoning.
Yeah, go ahead.
Does the board have to be unanimous?
Unfortunately, you need six for a special permit, and there's only six of us sitting here right today. So I'm not going to call for a vote if he's going to vote no.
Okay. Well, I'm going to ask you for a recess. If he's going to do that, I'm going to ask you for a recess and ask him to talk to you for 5 minutes.
My point is, I think that I need time to, as a board member, to look at this and understand this, because this isn't a private company. This is a town project. And as a town project, it's a, yes, we have the bylaws, but we also have some level of oversight and planning that people look to us for. I would like to have feedback from the Board of Selectmen on this. Not just that it's a done deal. I mean, I don't want to hear it's a done deal. That's,
well, I think
it doesn't affect my question.
I think Ben gave you the feedback. It is, you know, it's in the best interest of the library to proceed. We don't want to delay them further.
But overall, there's a bigger picture, too, is parking downtown needs to be addressed overall. Besides,
that doesn't have to do with this.
No, but
this right here is what we have to vote on, these three points, A, B, and C.
But I don't feel comfortable voting on this as being an answer for one of them until I have more information. I don't want to say yes or no. I just want to have more information sooner than sitting down at the table right now.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, through you, I stipulate that I do this under duress. I think you're wildly outside the bounds of your jurisdiction. I think you're acting inappropriately with regard to the Board of Selectmen's prerogatives. And I'm only doing this to facilitate, hopefully, moving this project ahead without further delay. So I want to make it very clear I'm doing this under duress. But my answer to you is the Board of Selectmen entered into this decision because it will benefit the entire community by enhancing the parking access downtown. The price that was negotiated with the church is related to the fact that, as the chairman indicated, we've always plowed Bill's parking lot. And that's been part of this sort of shared use agreement with them. In essence, what happens is the church has it taken care of, and so the payment to them is really to sort of compensate them partially for all the expenses they'll incur, the extra wear and tear, the plowing, all that that's going to occur as a result of the increased usage of the parking lot. So it is a negotiated number. It is well within the metrics of what we believe is acceptable for a community to pay on a per spot basis, on an annual basis. And this is not a huge money-making operation for the church. This is just the fact that the parking lot's not going to now last as long. It's going to need some extra service. It's going to have to be plowed on days it might not be. And so we're going to compensate them for that. So it's pure and simple. It's really the church trying not to lose money or incur extra costs on our behalf, and us trying to keep them whole. And so I want to be clear: it does not say that only the spaces may only be used for the parking for the library. It basically says the town has access to 40 parking spaces. And again, the costs were derived in a rational manner based upon how we've treated other parties in the past, whose resources we've also used.
I personally agree entirely with what Ben has said. I mean, it's now, you know, in fairness, did we get this, you know, right at the start of our meeting? You know, it'd be nice to have read it before that, but, you know, everyone has kind of read through it, and Elaine has read through it, provides more, Mr. Richardson?
So, again, I think that basically the town has been trying to find additional parking for a number of years. The cost of to build a parking space usually runs in the $4,000 to $5,000 per space. First, you have to have the property to do that. The town has not been successful in obtaining property to build a parking lot. So basically, again, under the mandate of the bylaws, we're now able to essentially rent spaces at $400 per space on an annual basis to solve the parking requirement for the library and also provide additional parking for the downtown area. Again, I would just reiterate and request that you focus on the fact that this is a special permit to provide the additional parking for the library. It accomplishes that, and nowhere in the zoning bylaws does it say you must not spend more than X dollars per space. But on the flip side, we're getting a very good deal based on the time and cost involved to actually build a 40-space parking lot.
Thank you. Through the chair?
Yeah, go ahead.
And sorry that the chair of our Board of Selectmen feels it was under duress, but your answer, second answer, made a lot more sense to me. A lot more facts were involved. I was unaware that the Board of Selectmen were already part of this process. I, again, to echo our chair's comments, we had just gotten this tonight. We often just get paperwork before our meetings, last-minute reviews, things like that, and I often find it uncomfortable to have to adjust and make decisions based on things I just looked at. There are questions I still have. I don't know what it costs to snowplow and maintain a parking lot. And I do think the value, in my mind, plays into this as a planning board member, because we do have responsibility to the town for planning. And right now, this is a document where it's saying that we have the spaces, yes, check mark. But the bigger question is it a value that I can sign off on as the part of a bigger picture? And the bigger picture is we do have a problem we need to solve in downtown, and this goes part of the way to do that.
This just contributes 40.
But I just need to know more.
Well, you know, one of the library is adding an assembly hall that requires a bunch, per our bylaw, mm-hmm.
right.
It requires
31
parking spots. This provides 9 more than what's required by the bylaw. This does a really good step. I mean, and it's in the right location. Mm-hmm. If you're driving to the library, you're going to turn down Church Street, you're going to look and you're going to see, geez, the new parking lot behind the library is full, and you're going to go the next half a block and pull into the church and then walk back a block, and go to the function. You might say that it's even a better location from a traffic flow standpoint than if we had filled up Bill's parking lot, you know, and built more 40 more spots there, 20 whatever.
Yeah, so we have a sidewalk coming right down there.
There's a sidewalk. It's a relatively low traffic. Yeah. You know, I think from a planning standpoint, it makes an awful lot of sense.
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, go ahead.
Jim Walker, Hayden, Rowe.
Yep.
Should this document have been made public for the public to be able to review it before the board votes on it?
Yes, no. I mean, at this point it's a public record at, you know, anything that comes before the board.
And how is it available to the public?
I'd be happy to let you look at it.
Okay. But just to be clear, the board's not voting on this agreement. Outside
that's
your
correct.
Purview.
Voting on the space.
All you're looking at is the number, the 40.
All we need to know is that the agreement provides the number. And you know, I think there is at least 5 of us up here that have come to that conclusion, having read that.
That's correct.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to ask the rest of the table this matter, because I would like to have more information. I want to look at alternatives that I don't see. I think $16,000 a year is one alternative, but maybe we should look at maybe reviewing what our bylaws are, and if we can't, we only have so much space.
Well, you're going to cost the town more than $16,000 if you delay the start of the construction, Frank.
Frank, just to reiterate what Ben said, this deal is done and signed, so the $16,000 a year is moot because it's being spent. The agreement has happened. What the agreement does is it gives the town the spaces needed for the library. That's really what our concern is. Does the library have enough spaces so that we can approve the site plan, or in this case, the special permit?
But my point is, sake of argument, because I think it needs to be talked about, and I don't mean to be a naysayer, but if, as a planning board member, I don't feel that it's a good value, I don't know if it's a good value, I don't know if it's a bad value, I just don't know. But say if I feel it's not a good value, then
the value,
I think that affects how I feel about the spaces.
It's a worse value if we say no, because we still have to pay the $16,000, and now we don't have spaces for the library.
Yeah.
Well, at least this way, we have to pay the $16,000, and we get the 40 spaces for the library by approving it.
Right.
If we say no, we still owe the money. It's a legal agreement. It's a legal document.
Frank, although I share your concerns, I think one of the things we have to be very careful of is the way the town is structured, there are committees responsible for different parts of a project. And the Board of Selectmen and the Permanent Building Committee have been involved with this, and this is clearly within their purview. It is not within our purview. We've never before looked at a project or an aspect of the project that's been approved by another committee and commented on the cost of that. And I think we got to be very careful about trying to extend our jurisdiction when it's not there, because what's going to happen is it's going to open the gates for another committee to now interfere what we're doing on the concern. I think the town has assigned that responsibility to other committees. They've acted on it, and I think as the board members here, as long as it meets our purview, I don't think we have the right or the jurisdiction to question another committee or the Board of Selectmen and what actions they've been taking. And I don't think, I can't see how you're going to, you know, in the future, it's going to open the Pandora's box if committees are starting to interfere with other committees' jurisdiction. So although I understand what you're saying, I think it's not within our scope of responsibility, and the committees that have that responsibility have acted upon it, and I think it's up to us to support them.
I hear what you're saying. So you said the Board of Selectmen has approved this agreement? I mean, I don't have that information. Is that part of the discussion?
I think you heard that from Ben.
It's been signed by the town manager. It's executed.
So has the Board of Selectmen approved it or not? I mean, that's...
We actually don't have to be frank. Right. But we're aware of it, and we've supported it all along. We told him to go into it and sign it. So he's acting under his authority based upon our direction. So he's...
But
we've been involved in this process the whole way along. We've always been aware of the cost. We've been aware of everything.
I'm not aware, though, so the board has...
Selectmen have done a good job on this.
All I'm saying is I need more information. If we had another member...
Well, there's
here,
no more information available. You want to hold it up tonight or not?
I want...
Are you going to vote for it?
I can't vote on it right now.
Okay, then
can I get a five-minute recess with you, Mr. Chairman, and with Mr. Durso?
Before recess, I have a question, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, go ahead.
The way I read this agreement is it's good through December 2018. It can be automatically renewed, but it can also be terminated at any time.
Yes.
With written notice.
And we will have clauses in there that if that happens, that'll be part of our conditions.
Okay.
Which we typically do.
And what...
And those are available on the sheet of paper on page 5.
They are available?
Yeah. Yeah, on page 5 of the Lanson memo.
Okay.
But yeah.
Hypothetically, through the chair, then if we do find alternative solutions, then... Don't blame me for not knowing this. I just sat down and haven't read the whole thing through.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask for a recess and have a conversation with you both.
Well, that'll be a first. We haven't had too many of those, but I'll be willing to take a water break for a second. We'll be in recess for about as soon as we come back.
Just to get another. It took about 5 weeks. So then you get the parking in the agreement, though.
I thought it was going to say, yeah, I think so. Wasn't it?
Seems like it's been like media.
Well, maybe that's...
I believe it's directly linked to this element of the project.
Does it meet the requirements of the bylaws?
This
is just one little piece of the overall scope of the project.
Yeah.
Good deal or bad deal?
Right.
It's the deal we got.
Well, it said, I know, it said, maybe we have a letter away from it.
Do you need it back?
Eventually. It's the only one.
Don't bleed on it. Don't rule on it.
No drawing.
That and Frank are still discussing. I'm gonna get some water.
Out tonight. Oh, jeez. This would have been our time to change the temporary library space, huh?
You can't make this stuff up.
No. So yeah, we'd have to take this to Superior Court to appeal.
Okay, let's get going again. Okay, we have, we're still talking about shared parking here. Thank you for your indulgence and, well, we had some discussions. Some folks want to take a vote on the shared parking, and if it's going to be a negative, that would also then reflect negative on the site plan review. I do not want to vote those things down and delay the project. Frank, I guess I'll ask you again, have you come up with enough that you can support it tonight or not?
If I could summarize some of the discussion that with further information from the Board of Selectmen, which I thank him for his time and efforts on behalf of the town. I feel that his second answer to me, which I said already, was more informative. Having just looked at this agreement, I appreciate Mr. Walker's review of that agreement and saying it's more flexible than I had originally thought it would be. I like the fact that it's for a period of time and we can be flexible about it and we can overall look for better solutions for downtown parking and something we're doing together as a town. And so I feel more comfortable approving the spaces for this project.
Okay. Further discussion?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
So I'm just reading the special conditions here, and it's not clear to me how it would be handled if you lost the agreement.
If we lose the agreement, then basically there is a...
And I'm quoting from your memo here. It says, seek appropriate relief of other shared parking agreements or that conformance with parking requirements is maintained.
Correct. And typically they'd be looking for another shared parking or they couldn't use the assembly hall in that period. And I would suggest, and I talked to Elaine a little bit about it, when we were going to talk about conditions, I was going to get rid of the words seek appropriate relief, even though that's always implicitly available.
So
yes, ma'am.
The use of that meeting space would be suspended until parking isn't going to be...
Yes, and the zoning enforcement officer is the person that would enforce that. Just like
use of that space for special events,
assembly.
But not for
library.
If Ronak wants to go in there and sit.
She can clean it, and yeah, but I mean, you cannot use it to a, where as a place of assembly for that.
So that just wasn't clear in the conditions as stated.
So are the conditions going to be rewritten to make this clearer?
We're going to be talking about those once we get closer to the. To the vote, but the first vote that this board would have to make is whether or not we find that, I'll say, all parking spaces at all parking spaces at 20 Church Street associated with the use are within practical walking distance of the library, and the grant of this special permit will be in harmony with the general purpose and intent of the zoning bylaw. And that's what we would be first voting on. And if somebody would like to so make that motion.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. So now we're discussing the motion that's on the table. Frank, are you comfortable enough to vote for it?
I'm comfortable. If someone could read the motion as it is, stands, just to be clear.
The motion is to make the following findings, that all parking spaces at 20 Church Street associated with the use are within practical walking distance of the library, and the grant of the special permit will be in harmony with the general purpose and intent of the zoning bylaw.
Thank you.
So that's the finding we're making. So it looks like you're ready for a vote. All those in favor, say aye.
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 All those opposed? All those abstained? Motion carries 6-0. Okay, the second one would be a vote to grant the special permit, and we're going to have some discussions of this before we go with the motion. And the vote is to grant a special permit to allow off-street parking on a separate lot at 20 Church Street under an agreement between the Town of Hopkinton and the Archdiocese of Boston with the following conditions. And if condition one is written on page 5, and I would take the word seek appropriate relief or...
other shared parking arrangements.
Basically, it would still read other shared parking arrangements, so conformance with the parking agreement is maintained. The second one is events, activities, and the like for the assembly space shall include a notification indicating the location of the off-street parking for attendees. The sign will be posted within the library parking lot that directs people to the location of additional parking. No certificate of occupancy shall be issued, which allows use of the building that require more than 24 parking spots pursuant to zoning bylaw 2010-124 until an off-street parking agreement has been fully executed, which provides for the additional parking at 20 Church Street, and such agreement provides the number of spaces which enables the entire building to comply with the parking requirements, period. And I propose that we get rid of the item C, which is to record the it at the registry of the deeds. So basically, that would be the approval for the special permit.
Does that need
with conditions?
Mr. Chair, does that need an amendment to
no,
the motion?
No, as I'm going to ask for the motion as I read it.
I'll make that motion.
Okay. Mr. Durson, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, we got a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. 6-0. So that's the special parking permit aspect of it. Okay, now we're on to the library itself. If I remember correctly from our outline, we had further discussions, I believe, on the setbacks based on the combining of the lots. I think there was some discussion still remaining on that. And the other thing was the final on some landscaping. I think those are the last two, and then we'll have some more public comment, and then we'll be voting on site plan review. So let's take up the combining of the lots and setbacks. Elaine, do you want to go through that a little bit?
The plan that eliminated the property line in between has been recorded, so it is one lot, it's a corner lot, and the Director of Municipal Inspections indicates that the building as proposed conforms to the setback requirements.
Okay. So, and that's basically part of what he has to do before he could issue a building permit.
That's correct.
And we have to do before we can issue a site plan approval. It's not up to this board to determine that type of interpretation, if I remember from what your memo said. So we can't have another interpretation of that. So to me, that point, I think for the board members, should be pretty well settled. Is there any further questions, comments on setbacks, etc.? Seeing none, let's go to the last item that I think was left from the outline, which was we had a couple of trees. And Wayne, do you want to summarize where the tree warden was?
That the thornless honey locust was appropriate in that location. It's a very hardy tree. It's surrounded on most of its sides by pavement. It'll do very well there, and it's appropriate. So he doesn't have a problem with that. He thinks it's a good place for it. The other question was the arborvitae. A resident asked if they will get enough sun, and he indicated that they will. He pointed out that the ones at the very end of the parking lot could be impacted by snow. I think one of the solutions was that it could be wrapped in burlap before the winter season to guard against that.
And for, I understand the the building committee decided to keep those arborvitae.
Yeah, we ran those same questions by the landscape architect, and he agreed with the tree warden on all those issues. And the landscape architect was the one that recommended wrapping it in burlap for the winter to try to protect it.
Claire?
You know what has occurred to me about those Dean I wonder if they would be helped by putting them in some sort of a bed. Like if you built up a bed with a wooden, you know, frame front to sort of give them some, so that they're not right down at the ground where the snow is pushed right up into them. You raise them up a little in, or give some kind of a, you know, wooden wooden planter type protection around them to give the soil some protection from the salt. And also maybe we could request, you know, there are areas where they do no salt, you know, just salt and sand. They because it's wetlands or whatever, request not using salt.
Yeah, but you don't want anyone to slip in that parking lot. You know, some of those old people use the library.
Well, I'm just saying, but I want to comment too on the honey locust, that Mr. Walker had a concern on the honey locust just because of the quality of the tree, and I did notice that in our notes, the even though the tree warden said that there's nothing wrong with the honey locust, he said there are other trees that can be used. And yeah, it's hardy, but it also is a junky, weedy tree. I mean, we could save ourselves buying a honey locust by just going to some, besides a railroad track somewhere, and pick one up, because you look in any vacant lot or along the tracks or whatever, that's what grows. It's honey locust. They are not a very nice tree. I know we had one in my backyard. It was a dirty tree. It was always dropping sticks and branches and leaves throughout the year.
I would
just confer with Mr. Walker that for his landscaping, if there was a somewhat better tree, I would like to see it.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, go ahead.
I did send a fairly lengthy email, and you were part of that email chain that I sent to you requesting maybe some other accommodations that the board could consider, which would be using my property to plant a more appropriate, what I feel is a more appropriate screening, with my concerns of what Claire is called, but also more screening in regards to traffic noise and lights. That would be more permanent year-round screening. And I don't believe I really ever got a full response that the town was not willing to consider that or provide that accommodation.
I did respond to you, Jim. We had a review by town council, and to plant on private property, we would have needed either an easement or a license from you to do that.
And I'm willing to give both, Mr. Chair. And it is part of the bylaws that procedure is available.
It is part of the bylaws to do that. The question is, how could we, or the building committee, interested in doing some more?
Well, the third part of that question, which I don't know the answer to, is does the town meeting vote allow us to spend money on private property? I don't know. But I'm sure that could get worked out. But I guess the bottom line is, you know, you required us to hire a landscape architect. We used taxpayers' money to get their opinion and put together a landscape plan. I think we should follow the landscape architect's recommendations.
Is there a fence along that property line?
Is there a fence?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. There's a fence.
Yeah. We have a fence there too. Mm-hmm. So, Claire?
If I may, it is understood that there will be landscaping around the property and proper screening, and that would be part of the budget for this project is screening, and whether it's put on this side of a property line or the other side of the property line, it's the same.
That could be the answer.
And I do feel that throughout the process of this library, the thorny issue has been the closeness to abutters and the impact on abutters and the fact that, you know, it is a tight spot. You have people that are very nearby, and you just can't, you know, you can't get blood out of a stone. It is where it is. Mm-hmm. But issues with dealing with the abutters in the most sensitive way and getting everyone behind this project have been paramount. So, you know, in the larger picture, a little bit of landscaping in the big picture is really a small thing.
We're not objecting to landscaping. We're absolutely doing landscaping.
I know.
And we've spent a considerable amount of time over this past year working with the abutters on this project. We've invited them to every meeting. they know exactly what's going on there.
Well, maybe they know what's going on, but if they have some requests for a type of landscaping that's going to make their lives easier, it just seems like it's a small thing to ask. It's one thing to say, we've talked to them, but if they have needs that still haven't quite been addressed, it just seems to me it's in everybody's best interest to address it. It doesn't sound like they're asking for a lot.
Mr. Chair, just to
go ahead.
Just a point. The finalization of the landscape architect wasn't done until very recently. It was changed on a couple of occasions also. So I've communicated, I believe, timely on this issue to the board and as clearly as I possibly could, and don't believe I've been fully given a response to my request for this accommodation.
So, if I put it down to practical things, what are you the trees you're looking for, or bushes?
Yeah. What are we looking for?
Either some sort of evergreen, hemlocks, anything that would be provide better screening. Full time, full year screening.
On your side of the fence.
Yes.
So there's a sick. So then, Mr. Chair, do we need still plant our plantings along our side of the property? We put up a 6-foot stockade fence, and then we're further looking to.
No, when I requested this, I said that removing the locust would also give you more room for your snow dump, and would not be needed if this accommodation was granted.
So, may I? So we're basically looking at planting hemlocks along the property line here and along here? Jim? Sorry?
No, just here. The south side.
Jim, just the south side. This is Jim's property line right here. He doesn't own this property here.
No.
Okay.
So we're looking at, I think, 2 honey locust trees that would be abutting him.
That's, this is an earlier plan, yes.
Right, but there are hemlocks across my
and that was one of the changes we made to extend the hemlocks all the way across your property and the Rogan's property.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So right now there are hemlocks along here.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct? And now what Jim is asking for is a couple of hemlocks on his property.
Mm-hmm.
And who maintains on his property?
Kind of right there.
We're glad to do that. We just, what are the logistics of maintenance? Well, I guess they're guaranteed for a year. If they die in a year, they get replaced. After that, then
he owns them.
Yeah. Do we have a problem with that? I don't have a problem with that. We can plant them even.
Well, we can. We can go out there and plant them.
But so we're talking two hemlocks.
I don't know that. I believe the property line is about 40 feet.
Mm-hmm. Hemlocks get about 20 feet in diameter. At least after a few years? No? Roy?
Well, it depends whose lifetime you want to screen it in. I mean, if you would have planted them, say,
to have a hemlock
10, 12 feet on center, you'd get, you know, say you're using maybe 8 to 10 footers or 7, 8, pick your own size, but depends how quickly you want them to spring.
Yeah.
That's right. You know, 20 years from now, they won't be that big, but.
Well, so if you maintain and cut the trees, they'll stay as hedges.
Yeah.
So if we put a condition in for 3 hemlocks painted, planted on his property, provided he gives appropriate easement.
Access.
Or access.
Easement, yeah. It's actually just access, one-time access, unless they, you know. They die. On the other hand, the land.
It's going to depend. It's going to depend. Who's going to maintain it? If the town's going to maintain it, we need an easement.
Gotcha.
If he wants to maintain it, then we can go on his property as a license.
You'll take care of it.
Yes, I'm maintaining my property today. Yes,
gotcha. Okay. So if we put a condition for 3, I'm trying to figure out where our conditions are here. Maybe condition 11. Any other comments, questions?
I have one question.
Yeah, go ahead.
How long will it take the 3 hemlocks to screen, roughly?
seems to have 8 to 10 inches a year.
Yep. What's that? I mean, I
still grow about 8 to 10 inches a year.
Three hemlocks, 8 to 10 feet.
That's what the, I think that's what the ones,
the other ones
behind
are.
Sue's house.
That's what the other ones were, too.
Was it 7 to...
I would prefer the 8 to 10. I don't know if they've been changed.
Okay.
Oh, they're not hemlocks. They changed it.
They're arborvitaes, I think.
Yeah, they're arborvitaes, okay.
These are old. This is an older plan.
That's an older plan?
I think so.
Okay.
Question to the chair?
Yeah, go ahead.
Last time we had talked about the landscaping, and I looked up honey locusts, and I read more about it after the meeting. There still will be some honey locust trees because they're kind of interesting trees. I don't think they're. I think they're pretty, but there will still be some involved. Or
no,
no?
The hemlock replaces the honey locust, right?
Well, we still have honey locust along the other butter's property.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
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 Okay.
And they're a reasonable tree.
Looks nice.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
yes.
So are you eliminating any honey locust, or
no,
are you just adding?
These are, we're adding three.
Okay.
On the neighbor's property.
Yeah. Okay. Have we exhausted landscaping at this point? Board members happy? I think that was. Oh, go ahead, Claire.
I just say, I mean, I had been talking with Dan about some landscaping in the front and the fact that I don't think that those perennial planting beds on the slope are going to grow very well. But, you know, if you want to put the perennials and then they die and then you go back and
well,
put junipers, it's fine.
We ran your suggestions by the landscape architect.
Yeah.
We talked about the salt resistance. He thinks his plantings are just as salt resistant as that one there. And they'll provide a real pop to the library. It's going to look nice.
Well, my concern is that winter in New England lasts 8 months. And so for a big chunk of time, there's going to be no blooming lilies. It's going to be brown mud and dried up leaves. And it would be a better overall look if you had some kind of a low-hugging evergreen that would be green all year long. But, I mean, it's not a make or break for me. I'm just saying, you know.
Over the life of the library, the landscaping is going to change, I'm sure.
Yeah, yeah. That was just a suggestion, and I know that, you know, Nancy's have some nice types of community that would work for.
Okay, I think we're to the point where we're into conditions of approval. Are there any comments or further comments by abutters or citizens? Any further questions from members of the planning board? Okay, so if I go to the area, our site plan standards, which are on page 3 of Elaine's memo, basically if you go through all the standards, I believe Elaine has given an opinion on all the way through standard R, that that they all comply or they're not applicable. So having said that, does anyone have any further questions on the standards and whether the library meets the standards? Seeing none, then we need to have a vote that the library complies. Well, let's talk about a few things before we do the vote. Is it two? It's two motions, isn't it, Elaine?
It could be done in one.
Couldn't be doing one? Okay, so let's try to do it in one. So on page 6, we have site plan conditions that have pretty much been there, and you guys are happy with the plus there's number 11, which is three hemlocks on the neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
One thing on the condition. Condition number 1, part of that no longer applies. The library did meet with the Historic District Commission and got approval for the modifications to the front ramp area. So that doesn't need to be, but the fact that it is in the Historic District and any changes that might come up as you go forward, it's probably good just to have the condition that recognizes that any other modifications would have to come to the district if there was a change. So I would
during,
just change
during the
that.
Building process, yes.
Yeah, I would change that just I would eliminate the front ramp area line. Just say no construction shall commence until the Historic District Commission has reviewed and approved any modifications to the exterior which requires such approval.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Since the ramp is
done. Make it easier.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay.
So they're happy with the ramp, so that's nice. Okay. last and final shot. Anyone have any more further comments on the library? Okay, seeing none, I would entertain a motion to find that the library project meets site plan approval standards A through R, and with the following 11 site plan conditions.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and second. Everyone understand what you're voting on? Mm-hmm. All those in favor of approving the site plan approval and conditions for the library, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. So the library is approved. We'll be issuing a condition probably within the week, because Elaine's pretty efficient at that type of stuff. And so I look for a motion to close the two public hearings.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Well, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Gentlemen. Thank you for all the hard work.
On behalf of the town of Hopkinton, thank you very much.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you. Thank you, Ben. We'll be happy to come there and help cut the ribbon.
Happy to smash something at this point.
Okay. The next item is our 8 o'clock public hearing that would like to continue to 7 p.m. on December 7th, Pearl Harbor Day. This will allow us to keep the rest of the schedule. We've got a fairly full hearing on the 7th. So this would be the public hearing on 3440 Hayden Rowe Street. Entertain a motion. Is 7 o'clock okay? We start a little bit early that day.
I may not be able to, but we'll see.
7's good for me.
If you can't do it, then we'll have to find another time, because I think we need all the votes, don't we? Because we're missing Claire and we're missing a couple other folks. For the guys in the tennis, we're running a little bit behind. The library, we spent a lot of time reading today, so.
7's okay for me.
What?
Yes, we did.
Frank? Are you still?
I may not be able to come in all the night. I will have to play it by ear at this point.
Would it be better on the 21st?
With Christmas?
Well, I mean, that's our next hearing.
Actually, I haven't planned ahead that far, so I don't know. Sorry. It might be an issue, though.
Do we have anything on the 21st at night?
You have something at 7:30.
And that's it. And then potentially at 8. So how about 9 on the 21st?
Or do we know for certain that the 7th won't work?
At 7, I think we need him, don't we?
Yeah, I'm just saying, if there's a possibility, you can always change the meeting back to 7:30 if it looks a week ahead of time. Looks like
we
can't do it.
I thought we were meeting on the 14th and
no.
Sorry.
The 7th and the 21st.
I'm out of sync since we November. So I don't know.
Actually, I won't be available December 7th.
So why don't we do it? Why don't we do it on the 21st? That's what it is. Look for a motion to continue the public hearing on 3440 Hayden Rowe Street to 7 p.m. on the 21st of December.
7 p.m.? I thought you said 9 p.m.
I'm sorry, 9 p.m. 9 p.m.
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
So December 7th itself is going to still be 7:30?
Yep. Yes.
Thank you.
And let's take up Rafferty Road at this point, because Mr. McDowell is here. And I promised that he could get out a little bit earlier. Rafferty Sidewalk. We have an email from the selectman And the selectmen basically asked us to do three things. One is to, they want their condition of removing the trees were to have an oversight group with the DPW director, the tree warden, a representative of the planning board, and a member of the public, which was Peter McGoy, and of course Mr. McDowell was there. And then I went to that on Friday. We went through the trees that were designated on Rafferty Road. I think we found that there's about 8 trees, I think it was, that could be, with minor changes to the route of the sidewalk, could be saved. So basically, from the board standpoint, I mean, nobody here wanted to cut any more trees than we needed to do. So basically, we had a consensus of that group that went out and walked. So basically, the selectmen have asked us to, one, reaffirm our vote in favor of the sidewalk on Rafferty Road. Is it needed? And is there anyone here that thinks that we were pretty unanimous on that the last time we voted. Does anyone think that this sidewalk really needs reconsideration? Seeing none, I'd entertain a motion to vote to reaffirm our requirement for the sidewalk that's required on Rafferty Road.
So moved.
Second.
Yeah. I don't think we really need to do this, but I want to respond to the selectmen's letter and do it very positively to say that. So it's been moved and seconded. Further discussion on the vote for Rafferty Road?
Can I just mention, yeah, maybe for people who are in attendance who came out of concern for the trees, that one of the things the selectmen did do was they also appointed Peter LeGoy, who's been active in open space and trails issues, to walk the site as well. And you know, I certainly respect Peter a lot for his concern about the natural environment. He's a runner, he's a hiker, and he wrote a very thoughtful email to the board where he did walk this, and there were, I believe, 8 trees that they did determine could be saved. And he mentioned here in his email, including 2 large trees that overhang the road and create the canopy that was mentioned as a nice feature. He said 8 fewer trees than originally planned will be moved. And he said most of these other trees, after realizing where they were and the difficulty of either encroaching onto land that doesn't belong to them or wetlands issues, Peter LeGoy as well concurred that these other removals were probably unavoidable, but they did find a way to save 8 trees, including some very significant trees contributing to the canopy. So personally, you know, if an individual gets killed on that road for lack of a sidewalk, I would feel bad that it was a tree instead of losing a life. And there is going to be housing up there, so I do support the sidewalk. But I wanted people to know that there has been a lot of thought gone into it, and as a result of the public's concern, a number of trees have been saved that are significant.
It is significant, but I would point out, in the original plan, at least in the first iteration of the plan, there were 9 trees marked as being retained. Mm-hmm. On the legacy farm, mm-hmm, proposal. So these 8 trees that are now being said to have been saved, were they on the original plan or in addition to the original plan?
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
After the selectmen's meeting, I went out there with my people and we tagged 9 trees that we thought could be considered for saving with some minor tweaks to the walk. After the site walk, one of those trees was eliminated from the 9 because the tree warden thought the tree was not well and needed to be taken down. Right. So we went from 9 saved to 8 saved.
Okay, so the 8 that were saved on this so-called oversight group which is a one-time meeting, so it's hardly an oversight group, but of the eight that were saved, were they part of the original nine that were marked on your drawings?
Well, yes, they were.
Okay.
In other words, there were 117 trees. Roughly, I'll say 70 of them, roughly, were on Rafferty. The rest were around the corner, cedar. We went out and marked those nine trees. They were part of the trees to be taken down. We marked the nine as potentially to be saved.
Okay.
And of those nine, eight were agreed upon.
What you just said is incorrect because the time out.
Well, I'm sorry, but you're not expressing what happened at the meeting. You were there at the sidewalk, sir.
Yes.
And we looked at every one of those trees. Yeah. We had a concurrence with the tree warden, the DPW director, everyone on the committee, and including Peter LaGoy, part of the selectmen.
Yeah.
And that is what that committee was. That is what the selectmen said to do to get the condition of the approval. The condition of approval has been met.
Well,
And for you to characterize that this committee is not doing the oversight is absolutely not correct, sir.
Well, hang on a second now. Oversight, does not the meaning of oversight imply, supervision and management? And can you consider a half an hour walk down that road to be oversight?
Wait a minute. He's the chair, so he runs the meeting, so this...
I'll take that as out of order, and I'm not even going to respond to it.
Oh, you're not? Okay, fine.
Yeah, it's, it is, the town has invested an awful lot in trying to accommodate the concerns of several folks in that area. And I'll leave it at that. Okay, I think we've got... The discussion, all we needed to do is vote to we did vote to reaffirm, correct?
I think you took a vote.
It's a discussion on
did we not take the vote on?
It was moved and seconded, but not voted.
Okay, so good. You're keeping me. No. So anyone else need any further discussion on this, members of the board? Seeing no further discussion, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay, so now let's get on to.
Thank you.
Let's go on to Zero Lumber Street, the Hopkinton Tennis Club, and we're running about a few minutes late, but we'll make a lot of progress today. Okay. We left it off at the last one. We were talking about lighting and we were talking about sidewalks because we knew those were the thorniest issues. Let me preface this continued public hearing with the following. We're not expected to vote tonight because we are still missing a few pieces of information. And if I remember Elaine's memo, we need an application provided. Well, first of all, there will be required a special permit application with the Board of Appeals for the Water Protection Overlay District that needs to be gone in parallel with this, or I think we could probably write a condition that would require put our permit contingent upon theirs, granting of that. That's one thing that we'd probably talk about. The lighting, because the revised plan consists of some 22-foot poles, that can be done with a special permit. And pending application today, pending good discussion today, I hope that you submit that special permit so that we can approve the plan when it's continued. And then, from what I understand, you're meeting with design review tomorrow on the basic building aspect, so we'll be looking to get that input at our next the following meeting. And then, so that's basically the reasons why we're probably not going to get there, but hopefully we're going to get fairly close on all the other major issues today so that it can be tweaked and we'll be ready to go, say, on the 20, first, I guess. Okay. So I think, why don't we start off with lighting, because that you got that one up there, and that one was of great interest. So.
Okay, so I'll submit some formal plans. Two copies. Just give me two full-size copies. So you got those. And I'll give everybody a handout as well, colored up, just to show you, if you don't mind. So what we did after the lengthy discussions and concerns raised at the last hearing is we went back and revisited the lighting design. And what I've shown here in the blue highlighted are the 15-foot fixtures that we're proposing around the perimeter of the site. And then on the interior, where we get close to really the major impediment for locating the light fixtures, the septic system, we propose 22-foot mounted structures. So we've got a total of 16 22-foot mounted and 15-foot mounted. But by doing that, what we achieved was a maximum lighting level of 10-foot candles, substantially reducing that from the previous application, and a minimum level of 0.6, which brings our average to under 3-foot candles, but also brings us into the ratio of the 20-to-1 min to max, which was also one of the lighting standard requirements. So we've met all of the reference standard requirements with this lighting design. We do have to have 6 22-foot mounted poles to achieve that, but they're on the interior. They're at a little bit lower elevation, so the delta difference of about 2 or 3 feet lower helps to offset that impact from that extended height. But also, you've had recent projects in town, just up the street, specifically the Dunkin' Donuts, I'm sorry, the Starbucks, and the Dunkin' Donuts also, where the lighting levels are above this, actually, with the high level and also the average. And so we think we've got a sensible design that's something within reason of even something down the street. Hopefully that addresses your concerns, but we can talk about a little bit more right now, if you'd like.
Claire?
Yes. I appreciate that you're making an effort to bring these poles down a little, but as I mentioned, it seems to me in my very recent recollection we've seen some projects come in that still had less light. And it's not that anybody wants a project to be unsafe, but there's very little correlation statistically between crime level incidences and intensity of light. In fact, the brighter the light, the darker the shadows, and the more unsafe people actually feel. But having said that, I went back to look at some of our other recent projects, and the first project I came upon was, you know, your kissing cousin, the Muse, the Hopkinton Muse, which was, according to my records, these are the plans that I had on the date that it was approved, which was June 22nd. And I looked at this lighting plan, and I'm seeing significantly lower light levels than are being shown here. This is a residential development. You probably got a lot more chance for pedestrians because they're walking between the buildings or out to the clubhouse or across the street to the commercial center, as opposed to a tennis club where you're going to mostly have people get out of their cars, go into the club, come out of the club, get into the car, and leave. And Paul Mastriani, in his Muse project, was trying very hard to be a good neighbor. And I was stunned to see the lower light levels at the Hopkinton Muse. And I'm reading here on the Muse, it said, the recommended lighting levels shown above are based on the Illuminating Engineer Society of North America for community shopping centers with medium activity level. The maximum mounting height shall be no greater than 15 feet measured from the ground at the base of the pole to the bottom of the fixture. ISNA recommendation, 3.6 average, minimum 0.9 provided, instead of 3.6, provided is 0.9 with a minimum of 0.1. Muse also used a very attractive gooseneck, more residential looking fixture that fits with the town as opposed to this industrial looking.
Muse, that's the shopping center, I think. It was
the shopping center. Okay. I thought it was in the Muse. But this is just a recently approved plan. So I just feel that, you know, save you money, that this lighting can come down, and it's in recent memory in a in a large center right down the street that's just recently approved. There's a picture that was in Preservation Magazine that showed the effect on the night sky, a neighborhood where the light, there was a blackout, and the difference where all of a sudden there were stars that you never even knew were there until the lights went out. And this is what happens when you get this collective glow all around. So I think you can comply with the 15-foot poles because they did it up the street, and I think these light levels need to come down even further, and it can be done.
Well, I think, Claire, though, the reason they went to the taller ones was mm-hmm. the fact that you can't space them closer because you're in the middle of a septic field. And so that's why they had to go to the taller ones in the middle of the parking lot, because you couldn't put spot, you can't put the pole in the middle of the septic system.
Otherwise, we would have some pretty dark areas right in the middle. Even if we did the best we could and then brought 15-footers and a higher density around that, we would still not be able to get that middle part of the septic system with safe lighting. And if we increase the output on those lights, then we would have really, really hot spots right underneath those fixtures. So it's kind of a balance that we think we've met, frankly, with this design that meets all the standards that you require just outside of the 22-foot poles. And we think really the 22-foot pole requirement is typically an aesthetic thing more than a safety thing. And we think we can overcome that by the location that the site is in. It's across from industrial use and zone properties. It's got surrounded by very thick vegetation. It's not ever going to be developed on three sides of it.
But it collects. The glow that you get in the neighborhood, it's collective.
I think that's typically for older style lights. With the new fixtures these days that they have with the downsky compliant lighting, mm-hmm. I don't think that's as much of an issue as it used to.
But I still think if I look at the intensity of lighting in here, I understand what you're saying, that you don't have as many places to put poles, so you're going with higher poles, but I still think you're looking for an intenser amount of light than is needed. There's a drastic difference between what is on this plan right up the street for you that just got approved in June, where you've got some areas to the outside that are down to a half a foot candle, and there are parking lots with a half a foot candle where people can feel very, very safe. I would really ask you to take a look at this most recently approved plan and look what they did and see if this can be replicated, because the difference is dramatic between these two plans.
We did look at the other sites I cited that were recently approved just up the street, literally at the intersection with this project.
Well, I'm saying this is right down the street from you, and it's part of the neighborhood. There was a desire for this whole complex to work together harmoniously, and there's a beautifully subdued plan as part of this complex. You know, it's not Dunkin' Donuts. It's in a wooded area, and if those lights can come down and accomplish the purpose, which this plan does, I don't see why that shouldn't be an objective.
Can I ask the question where the hot spots really are? That
we're on this one that we're talking about? The worst level is a 10, that's right here in the middle of this access aisle, but as you get even adjacent to the light itself, it goes down to a 4. Then as you get to the property line, not even the edge of the road, you're at 0.2s, 0.3s. As you get to the edge of the road, you're 0s, you have a couple stray 0.1s. So if you're up at the street in front of this project, you have no impact at all from the lighting design. And same thing around the perimeter of the project, you're at 0.1. all the way around on that side, and you're at zeros on the other side.
So the 10 is below a 12-foot fixture or 15-foot fixture.
When you say the 10 is...
The hot spot is below the shorter fixture.
That's correct. Yes.
I don't see anything even approaching a 10 on this. On
it's,
this
it's, right, it's probably hard for you to see if that's...
No, I'm looking at it.
No, I'm
saying in this one that just got approved up the street, there's nothing close to a 10. They're all 1s, 2s, less than a half a foot candle. Good. Well, we're beating a dead
horse.
They
might not have had the same restrictions we had. Obviously, if I had a layout that was the same as theirs, I probably could accommodate a different layout, but I don't have that.
I recognize that, but I'm saying if you've got places that have tens and eights and sevens, and this is having things that are ones, there's a lot of distance in between there that says to me, something can give. Mm-hmm. Maybe you can't get down to this, but you can get lower than what you've got. And maybe it's the wattage in your lights. I don't know how it all works, but I find it hard to believe you can have two brand new projects within spitting distance of each other, and you can't bring the lights more down into accord with this very good neighbor project that just got approved.
It seems to me that if the 10-1 area is probably because you've got a couple of lights fairly close to each other.
But you're not seeing any 10s on this one. You're seeing 1s and 2s throughout.
Typically, in order to reduce levels, you have to bring in more lights or reduce the wattage. Mm-hmm. So you're going to sacrifice something somewhere. So you're going to maybe make the levels lower in some areas below safety standards, which I didn't think that's what you'd want to do here. So that's why we came up with this.
Well, we're going around and around and around. The issue is that there's nothing that says that incredibly bright lights equals safety. In fact, there have been studies have shown there's absolutely no correlation between more light and less crime. And again, we have a plan here.
It's more than just crime. Light. And my example is when I foolishly was trespassing on the industrial property across from my daughter's house to watch the 4th of July fireworks. I think it was this year or last year. Okay. And I stepped off a 12-inch curb thinking it was a 7-inch curb and, you know, went down pretty hard on the ankle, etc. And, you know, I guess I'm just getting to the point where I need a little bit more light. But
We just approved a plan with a lot less light.
Sure. That's not to say that you couldn't maybe tweak a couple of the hot spot areas by probably location moving or whatever. But
well, you're not going to get my vote if you have overkill on the lights, I'll tell you right now.
Okay. Can you just give us an indication of what overkill is?
This plan. Look at this plan and look at what they've done and say, how can I bring, maybe I'm not going to get these levels, but you've got this much difference between your plan and their plan.
What about
maybe there's something down there. I'm not going to give you an exact number. I don't know an exact number, but I'm saying it obviously can be done, and it's done in very deep recent memory, like June.
I'm not saying that we couldn't produce a 10 to an 8 or a 10 to a 7, but that's what I'm saying. I don't want to come back with another plan that you say we're not good enough, come back again.
Well, if you look at this plan and assume that this level of light is deemed appropriate for a shopping center, then I'm saying that I believe the level of light that you're looking for, that you're calling appropriate, is more light than is really needed. It's clear that there are projects coming into this town right now with significantly lower light levels that are deemed by both the applicant and this board to be sufficient.
I don't doubt that at all. It's really...
So why not here?
Every site is so specific. There's so many... I wouldn't have a job if it was easy to design all these sites the same.
Oh, yeah. And I'm not asking you to replicate this plan. I'm saying this says to me that
There's wiggle room.
Okay. Try it.
Okay.
Okay, I understand.
Do better.
Okay, so...
I have a comment.
Go ahead.
I agree with Claire a lot on this, and I should apologize. Last time we spoke, I was going to get more information from the Conservation Commission, because I'm still kind of... I don't understand how the parking lot has a situation that it has, that you need to have the lights higher and all that. So I wanted to get... Part of it is how the board discussed what their findings are and how, you know, do you look through the minutes or... You know, is there direct communication? And I was supposed to talk to them. I didn't. But your septic system under the parking lot, is there any other alternative to that than what you have? I don't want to put the lights before the septic or septic before the lights, but as a whole, this fits in with the other projects around it, and it does have a larger light pattern, more intensity than the others. And if that's one of the reasons, maybe we could look at it. And I just don't have enough information. I keep on saying that, but this is on me. I should have gotten more information, but I don't have it right now. But as a whole, maybe the whole thing could be looked at.
The septic design is really what drives a lot of sites, frankly. When you're on septic systems and not sewer, you oftentimes, your whole development, and sometimes projects just can't even happen because the septic design doesn't fit with whatever program a developer might have. We're fortunate that even with the large flows that are required for a project of this size, we could fit a septic system. This is a 6,000 gallon per day septic system. They have to provide primary and reserve, all Title V standard. We're able to design that, and that's not a small feat on a site that doesn't have ideal soils, groundwater level, and perk levels.
So that's gauged on the number of bathrooms, showers, whatnot?
It's gauged on the, this one in particular is gauged on the lockers, because that's the only Title V design guideline that we could pick that actually gave us something. So, and that's, can fit, so it's going to restrict how many lockers can be put in for people that use the facility. And it's really, you have other restrictions, obviously with the wetlands, you can only go so close with the septic. And when you pick that septic and it starts to tell you what your groundwater level is and what your top of your system are, that spiders out into everything. It touches every other part of your design aspect of the site, from your stormwater design to your levels for the buildings and access and everything. So we picked up front because we were taking advantage of some of the grade change that's already going on there. And we realized, even on this low side of the system, we have to have a 10-foot fill just to get to the bottom of the septic system. That's substantial, and it's a huge cost impact, but it's something we have to do because that's the only place that we can fit it. And we looked at a number of iterations. We actually had to show conservation all the different alternatives that we had looked at and vetted out, and that's all on the record if you want to look at those. So
thank you. Thank you.
We looked at a number of different. This was what we ultimately landed on because we felt it was the best fit.
Okay. So basically, I think for today, let's say we're almost there on site lighting, but another one more pass.
Okay.
Just want to mention one more thing. I don't know if designer, if you had brought this up, we'll bring it up. But again, when I was looking back at this other Lumber Street property, and they had this very attractive light fixture, and it is nice if we think of maybe coordinating these developments. The shoebox fixture, you have a wonderful design with that Adirondack kind of lodge look. It's got kind of a country woodsy look. I think you could do better than this really industrial looking fixture. Maybe look at something that is a little more in keeping with the style of the building, and you might look at the Lumber Street business development as a guideline.
Okay,
let's go to the next one, that follow up on our sidewalks that we talked about the last time.
Another handout plan on that one. So what we did last week was we informally met on the site on Friday, the chair of the planning board, but also the chair of the conservation commission, and walked a potential route to see what the impacts might be to the wetlands, to see the viability of putting a sidewalk in from the project area up to the remaining parts of the project. So this is us here at lot 7. We have an open space. Lot 5, and then you have Lot 4, and then you have the ongoing project as you get closer to West Main Street. So the talk was that the obligation eventually of connecting from the driveway of Lot 3 all the way down to the driveway of our project. And in looking at that, if you can follow this dashed dot line, that's the actual edge of wetlands. And if you walk out on this side of the road, you can see where it is. There's still blue flags or evidence of the blue flags out there. There isn't much of an existing shoulder. It drops off about 4 feet, is around 4 to 5 feet, I'd say, is probably the most dramatic drop-off. And then you have the edge of the right-of-way, which is a stone wall. To put in a walkway there, sure, it could be done, but it would take some disturbance, likely, of the actual wetland itself to put in a retaining wall, secure it, and get in the minimum required shoulder and sidewalk width that the DPW would be looking for. So we actually looked at the possibility of crossing the street with a good sightline location and going on the other side, which was relatively flat. It was away from the resource area. And then crossing back over, again, at a good spot that was within good sightlines, and getting back on that same side and continuing across, again, in an area that you had a bigger buffer between the wetlands, but was also relatively flat. It seemed to make sense out there, and we understand that the master plan special permit didn't have explicit language as far as a responsibility for Lot 5 or the open space.
It talks about when each individual lot is brought forward for development, that they would be obligated to do sidewalk across their frontage. But we understand that in all likelihood it was probably meant to be for lot 7. So we understand that you would probably look to have the sidewalk installed for this project up to the border of lot 4 and 5, and then whenever lot 4 comes on for development, that remaining connecting piece would be brought in into the fold. So we understand that might be part of the approval, and we have no issue with that. We could obviously develop plans in more detail, subject to review of the DPW and occupancy not granted until the sidewalk was put in place to their satisfaction.
I think there's two or three issues that we need to discuss as a board. Number one, are people comfortable going back and forth? And as we were walking down the shoulder of Lumber Street, it's still not that busy that, you know, other than the fact we were taking our lives in our own hands a little bit, but whether or not you could get across with proper sight distance back and forth. It is, as he stated, a lot more difficult to build on the wetland side. It's not impossible. I think Jeff Barnes would, and Concom would accommodate it with replication and everything else that would have to go along that to that section on 5.
But did you say the sight distance was okay here?
Yes.
To cross?
At that point, it was pretty good.
And cross back both,
yep,
points?
I think this makes, it's open for discussion. Does this meet the requirement to get the connectivity that we're looking for? I mean, given what what Mr. McDowell had to go through for filling the area along Lot 5, if you went on the wetlands, would be small compared to some of the stuff he did on East Main Street. But then again, we're not trying to do that either, I don't think.
I looked at this, I'm sorry, to the chair.
Go ahead.
I looked at this on Friday, and I wasn't aware of this street crossing idea. And I remember previous discussions from Concom and our discussions here. I do think there is space and pre-disturbed land along the side of the road that would be appropriate for a sidewalk along Section 5. And but I wasn't being aware of
the alternative
crossing. Yeah, that I guess it's interesting. I'm a little bit concerned because the road straightened out right around there, and people speed up a little, or assume they speed up a little. But we could bear something into.
How long a stretch is this? The crossover part. How many feet is this?
Probably about the whole total,
yeah,
that section there. Yeah. It's probably in the neighborhood of just under 400.
400, and
yeah,
that's like, what is about 100 feet between the telephone pole? Okay, help me visualize 400 and try to find.
Oh, a little bit longer than a football field.
Okay, that's a pretty long stretch.
And that's along the McIntyre.
That's actually near it's kind of partially on McIntyre, in fact, partially in front of McIntyre. It would be in the public right away.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And it's,
that's where the best sight line was to cross, and then it's relatively flat on that same side of the road. You've got actually an extra wide shoulder area there, because you can see the stone wall, what's probably the apparent right-of-way limits on that side. Mm-hmm. And then when you get back and around the corner into a good sightline location, you can cross back again, and it just happens to coincide where you start to get away from the actual edge of wetlands that was up close to the edge of the roadway, and it goes again to a flat area and carries through right through the front of lot 4, right up to 3.
What's the timing on lot 4? Do you have any plans yet?
I don't have any plan right now.
So I think the question before the board for discussion is whether or not there's a requirement to go across lot 4 at this point, or that just waits.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, the length of the crossed over portion, I think, is long enough that people would use it. The reason I was asking how long it was, because I thought if it was a short section, people just won't use it. They'll just walk in the road.
Oh,
but
yeah,
if it's 400 feet, it's probably long enough that it would be worth someone's while. They actually would use that. So,
if you got a chance, I would drive. You'll see. It's pretty apparent.
Yeah, no, so that kind of makes the case for me on that, but I am concerned if Lot 4 doesn't get developed, because to me the whole purpose of this is to connect particularly to the housing, the newest development. And if for whatever reason, economy or whatever, we've had other commercial spaces in town that have been slow to actually get someone to, you know, move into them, we get a sidewalk to nowhere and you get people walking on a really dangerous road. So I'm having a problem with not having that be a full working sidewalk.
If I might just
go ahead.
The Massive Special Permit actually talks of this and talks of how with each lot being submitted for site plan review, then that applicable lot will have the sidewalk along its frontage put in.
Mm-hmm.
So the special permit contemplates kind of the sequential happening rather than the first guy having to pick up all of it. Maybe more importantly, for the appropriate design, the special permit also refers to the possibility that Lot 4, rather than having a traditional sidewalk, can have the meandering natural surface walking path, which would get obviously incorporated into the development or design of Lot 4 when you know what's going to happen there. So as we read the special permit, but for the fact that to some extent Lot 5 was left as an orphan, for lack of a better term, and we could see how being at the end then that might end up being our responsibility, we saw it as separate, and therefore when Lot 4 knows what they're going to do, figure out where the sidewalk or the path fits in best.
My rebuttal for that might be, number one, we're not requiring it over the length of Lot 7, and two, the town just helped Paul out by taking all along West Main Street at the town expense and put in a lot of things. I'm not just saying that you guys as the owner of 7, but and looking across over at Paul, that
keep
you know,
looking over there.
I mean, you know,
that's so good to me.
Well, you know, you can, on sidewalks so far, you're doing pretty good.
We love sidewalks, Kevin.
I know we do. Claire,
Mr. Chairman,
yeah?
That makes me even more worried, because the prospect that a traditional sidewalk along the road could be substituted for a meandering path. Once you get a meandering path, it's not going to be plowed in the wintertime. And my biggest concern, the biggest need for sidewalk is going to be in the winter months when it's dark and it's hard to get out to exercise, so people are more likely to want to go from the Mews up to the tennis club. There's snowbanks on the side of the road. The road is narrow. It's dark. And that is the most dangerous time of the year and the time that you're going to need a sidewalk more than ever. And that is when you're not going to use a meandering, wandering path through the woods when there's 3 feet of snow on the ground.
If I might, that all gets to the issue of design and maintenance, which is appropriate as part of the site plan review for Lot 4, if Lot 4 comes and proposes it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm simply pointing it out as part of the massive special permit, left the door open for Lot 4,
mm-hmm.
for Lot 7, to also have that in some fashion. I don't know whether it makes sense or works. It can only be determined once you know what Lot 4 is going to be used for and how it's going to be designed. So what we're just suggesting is that the issue be left until that does go forward. You know, with the development on both sides of it, I don't think it's a question of being left. It's only a matter of question when it's going to be developed, not if it's going to be developed.
Well, you know, why don't we think about that one a little bit more and really kind of all of us think about it and figure out where we're going to go with that. Let's try to move on to some of the other items.
I think at the last meeting there was also discussion of whether sidewalks would continue south of that. I don't know if that was resolved at the last meeting as well.
I thought we came to a conclusion that we were comfortable with not putting sidewalks on Lot 7 in front of the entire way, but that the parking lot would be landscaped and put together in a way that it wouldn't preclude or make
parking
lot make it impossible to put a sidewalk there without great expense. I mean, we're looking to, as I kind of remember, there's not much along Lot 7, there's not a lot of great trees that's kind of on that side of the road, per se.
We show proposed grading going up to the edge of the road that will be necessary, frankly, to establish what we have proposed for grades and landscaping on the project site.
And so
and none of them are steep that you couldn't put in a sidewalk down the road if you had to.
So as long as we have a location for the sidewalk in the future, if, let's say, the Gun Club decided to cease, which I don't think they ever will, but you never know, and you know that would be a prime piece of development for all sorts of stuff if you weren't practicing. Okay, let's try to knock out some of these other ones here. Because a couple of reasons I want to make sure that we get some action items going for there. Let's try them in order real quick. The pedestrian and vehicle traffic flow in the parking lot, parking design, you want to kind of walk us through that. And then there still seems to be a question of how many parking spots are required by whatever the occupancy is. And Elaine, who is going to verify that requirement or whatever?
Our building inspector will verify that. So they received additional information today, and they'll take a look at it.
Okay, so they're in the process of doing that. So that's our action item. Okay, so assuming that the number of 123 is correct, tell us how it works.
For the circulation, the first one? Okay, sure. So we provided, that was also a question that came up from your peer reviewer, Beta Engineering, and we had provided them with a exhibit using a program called AutoTurn that shows you movements of delivery-sized vehicles going through the site or emergency response vehicles going through the site. So the main circulation would be on primary entrance in, coming in front of the building, and then they'd be able to circulate back out. So we have full uninhibited access for emergency vehicles and also for standard delivery trucks, which would be a box truck, if you will. You're not going to get WB-50 tractor trailers that would have any reason to access the site. Pedestrian access, as we had talked about, there would be a sidewalk connection that would connect along the perimeter of the parking lot and come into the main entrance, but then also you're going to have, main entrance here, walk into back here, and then you'll have sidewalk across the front and also access to the parking stalls along the front of the parking lot. And that's primarily how the circulation goes through the lot. We don't see any issues with it. No issues were raised by Beta as a result of that design.
What if you did have a delivery of a tractor trailer truck bringing equipment to that site? What would happen?
Bringing equipment to the site?
So you need to replace all your nets, and you get a big truckload coming, and where would that tractor trailer park?
If they had to, unfortunately, they would, to make it safe, they'd have to pull in, drop off, and they might have to do a back out movement. But honestly,
it's
they
doable.
Can do deliveries on smaller trucks or something like that type of equipment. All the big deliveries will be during construction, or obviously we won't have the inhibitions that we have when it's fully built.
But it is a valid question, because Starbucks gets deliveries from tractor trailer trucks, can't fit in their sidewalk, and it's like, and they block up the street, so it's Lumber Street gets a little bit blocked up there, and I know we're going to do the widening and stuff that will help, but not actually on Lumber Street where Starbucks is, so as long as you guys feel comfortable with that, if it's in a special case or whatever, it's considered, you can do it.
Yeah, actually the timing was appropriate on Friday when we were out there. There was an extra wide load delivery that was happening across the street with somebody with boats on the back of their trailer, and they were actually able to pull up and back into that, which I was kind of impressed by, given the size of the road and the vehicle doing it. So it can be done, just everybody's got to wait a minute while he does it.
Does anyone on the planning board think we need a condition on, I'll say, limiting timing or of commercial things? This is in a commercial center without residential. Well, residential is relatively far away. I mean, there is Lot 5 open space between that and the Muse. I'm not seeing anyone saying that they think that that is really needed. Okay. Are we done with deliveries and vehicle traffic other than confirming the 123 spots? Anyone else have any further issues in that area? Okay, seeing none, let's go on to stormwater management. I believe there's a clean report from Beta at this point on stormwater.
I believe so.
Elaine, that was in our package the last time around, wasn't it?
Yeah, nothing new since the last time.
Right. So we're set on stormwater? Yeah?
Yeah, we had suggested a condition, and the applicant had, at the last meeting, indicated that was amenable to them. So.
Okay.
I think we're good.
Okay, utilities, why don't you explain what you're getting here?
Sure. So we've talked at length about the septic system.
Yep.
I think I need to go into that anymore. The other big one is water, and water we have to actually extend down from the site. Currently, it's stubbed off with some hydrants right about in this area right here. So we'll have to bring that down on the same side of the street. It's about 1,100 feet to get to the driveway, and then bring it into the site. And we'll bring it into the site and down to the side. Basically, all the penetrations happen down in this area for electric, gas, water. And gas is fortunately in the street as well. It's on the same side of the street as our project, so we'll be able to tap off the gas line for that. We have poles in the area. We'll be able to pull off of that for electric to a transformer. So all the utilities are available with a little bit of extension work for the water and the design for the septic. The septic design is formalized. We're going to submit it this week to the Board of Health for their review, but it's done.
The water pipe size that they're requiring an extension? Is that a 10-inch or 8?
They've done the analysis. They've told us informally that it's fine. There's adequate water pressure, no booster station needed. We just haven't got anything in writing as far as what size they'll require or where gating is going to be, any of the, some of the other nitty-gritty design elements that sometimes to get added in. We've just been told that it's going to be acceptable and they'll allow for it.
Okay. And your electrical feed from the pole into the building is all underground?
Yes.
Okay.
Show that on the plans.
Other questions? I assume phone and all that is underground too.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions for utilities? I don't think we care what size main is. When I was a water commissioner, we were hoping to put a 10-inch main down Lumber Street.
I would imagine they would ask for something sizable to extend down the road in the future. That's usually
something,
what they do.
Yeah. That ends up being a fairly major loop eventually if it ever gets connected.
Sure.
Okay. Item F is compliance with the neighborhood mixed use design guidelines and master plan special permit. Elaine, is there anything that we need to worry about here?
I don't think at this time there is, no.
And the design guidelines, we'll hear from the design review board with tomorrow. The wetland buffers and CONCOM issues, I think we put that on before we knew that they were approving it. I think part of the thing is we're explicitly approving some recharge stuff within the buffer areas or the setbacks for sure.
Yes.
And I don't know whether anyone saw any options, but I'll tell you, this site is used as much as it can be used. I think I don't think there's too many square feet that are available. And the fact that CONCOM has approved it makes it a lot easier. Okay, building design we'll wait until we hear from design review for those two.
Would you like a sneak peek at it? Let's
get the sneak peek.
Chair, Chairman, Louis LeBay, Applied Foam Space Architects. Basic overview, this is the ground floor level, which is actually below the level where you enter the building, quick overview of the functions on this side. Half basketball court, which is a double height space, fitness classrooms, exercise areas, locker rooms for the gym portion, the fitness portion, and locker rooms for the pool portion, some mechanical areas, and the main circulation space for the air supporting structures, which are directly outside, which will each have an airlock, allowing access between the building and
why is there a difference between, and this doesn't have much, a locker room for the pool and the locker room for the other part? Why?
Because the locker rooms for the pools typically get wet, and so you need to design them differently.
Okay. My information. Yeah. Okay.
Does that mean there's drains in the floor and things like that?
Typically, yeah. It's just a different,
space.
I mean, and the tennis people and the fitness people, they don't like to walk into, a wet tile floor, so.
Do you sell different types of memberships then, like fitness only or tennis only?
A variety, probably 20 different
units. Combinations?
Exactly.
Okay.
First floor level, which is actually the floor that you arrive at, the parking areas on this side, there's a walkway, a patio deck that gets you to the main door, which is over here. And the configuration of the building, like much of everything else on the site, was really dictated by the site conditions and the septic system requirements. This is a covered area, covered roof area, so that at least you're protected from the weather as you come in. When you walk in through here, your main lobby and reception desk, there'll be child care drop-off in this wing of the building with activity rooms.
And that's for, like, if I'm at the gym, I can drop off my grandkid and okay.
Exactly.
Not for child care.
Not commercial.
You got to be a member.
Not exactly. Care center.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Building code-wise, it's the same thing as a daycare center, but functionally from the town's point of view, it's only for the membership. The darker green areas, sort of color coordinated. This is what we call the clubhouse area, where there'll be a bar, snack bar, lounge area with some seating for, again, serving the membership, not a full service restaurant. Main circulation area with a stair down to the lower floor, elevator down to the lower floor, pro shop in this general area here, and then the large fitness room. Here. This will accommodate the vast bulk of all your free weights, treadmills, elliptical equipment. Viewing deck directly outside, so which will overlook the six tennis courts. So on this side, we'll have the six tennis courts, which are which will be open during the warm weather season. And here we have the four tennis courts on this wing, which will be enclosed the entire time. Cool is out to the city over here. Style of the building, I think Claire mentioned it. We, because of what the site was before in the wooded area, we thought that it's sort of an Adirondack style, almost mountain lodgy type feel, would fit well within the space. And because we have this relatively long area to get to the front door, it's like we took the opportunity to make the elevator into a tower, so at least it gives you a visual signal of the direction that you're going to when you arrive here. This is the parking lot elevation. As you can see, there's about a 10-foot drop down to the lower level, which allows the building itself, even though the top of ridge is 42 feet above the lower level, you're really 30 and a half feet above the parking lot level. Then we looked at it with the dome structures. We have a general massing idea. We left out all the trees that are remaining, so don't be alarmed by the lack of trees that are shown. This is the cold weather configuration with the domes up. Large court dome, four court dome, pool area. And here's an elevation from about street line that shows you the relationship of the domes to the building. And because though the courts are at the lower level, which again 12 feet down from the main level, and the height of the domes are somewhere between 36 and 38 feet, you actually have domes that are lower than the ridge line of the main structure. And this is the warm weather configuration with the dome, with the air supported domes down. Mechanical equipment is hidden within a trough, concealed within a trough on the roof.
Why do you deflate some of the domes during the summertime, other than the fact that you?
Because people, a lot, those are clay courts, and people just like to be outside. They don't. They're tired in the. Being in, inside in the winter, okay. All winter, so.
Are all 10 courts clay or synthetic clay?
No, the four courts are hard courts, okay. That are, and typically the reason you do that is for junior programs. The younger kids like the hard courts.
Yeah, us older people can't.
No, exactly.
Speak yourself.
Again, essentially, the building nestles in, I think, quite nicely into a, you mentioned that a site that basically uses as much, every square foot we could use to make the program work. A lot of that square footage, obviously, is a landscape area and drainage area, but the building fits in nicely from the street level. It's a very relatively small scale building, even though it's, 39,000 feet. From the street side, you see something that's that fits in scale-wise very well into the neighborhood.
Any comments, questions, or comments, questions that one might have for our design review board?
How easy would it be to hold a an occasional larger tennis exposition or something with a special match or something like that?
Have to get a waiver from the building inspector for our maximum occupancy, but certainly the space itself, I think, will accommodate. I think that's a question for Donnie, whether or not the building.
I'm not sure I understand the question.
I've done some work with the Boston Lobsters, so mm-hmm. They're at a country club in the same kind of format. Mm-hmm. Then when they come and they play, it's a special setup, and it's, mm-hmm. It's kind of a fun event and everything. So I was wondering, could you also do fun events of that sort?
Yeah, I used to play with Bailey Brown, who was one of the founding members of the Boston Lobsters. Yeah. So, because actually that building size would be bigger, for example, than at Westboro. So, and there's viewing both ways. So you're going to look into the six-court bubble and you're going to be able to look in the four-court bubble. So if you, and those guys might want to play in high courts in some cases, or if they're getting ready to play in a French Open or something like that. We used to have people that would play in the French Open, which is clay, as you know. They would come in there and practice on the clay courts if it were getting ready for a hard court surface, they would kind of play in the hard court. So that's the reason for the mixture of the hard courts. And
I don't think you could do a Boston Lobster event here on the site.
Special
all.
Events here and there.
Well, smaller ones, but I don't think I've been to the Lobsters too, and it's just there's a lot of people there and a lot of cars, and they're parked all over the place, which makes fun, but I mean, that's. The site is not, I don't think, set up for what they're trying to do. Claire?
I'm sure you'll be working with the fire department to make sure you meet all the requirements, and we're, your parking lot's all kind of on one end of the building. Have they weighed in if they feel comfortable with being able to have full access to all sides of the site for their equipment in the event of a fire?
Jessica could better speak to it, but there's this access aisle that they requested, a 20-foot wide fire lane that goes down to the pool level, so they can get all the way down there. And then we're level all the way around, essentially level, so they can reach.
They can drive around the truck. Backside too.
I don't know if they'd be able to drive around, but they can bring their hoses and equipment.
That's right. Okay. It's vehicle access up to basically the intersection with the pool area, so you can get an ambulance, let's say, down there in case you had some emergency at the pool. And then just to have access around the whole perimeter, we have a 10-foot wide minimum
essentially level area around all the bubbles, mechanical equipment, everything on the outside perimeter of the site.
Okay, so if there were fire, they could get their engines or their hoses
right, it's for
fully around the building.
And of course the building will be fully sprinkled. And even though these are large areas, the air-supported structures, you're going to have a relatively small occupancy in there because, I mean, you're going to have four people per court and then some people mm-hmm. even.
Do bubbles get fire suppressed too?
No.
Okay.
There's a separate section of the building code that deals with the air support structures.
Not much to burn either. Because if it starts to burn, it falls down on you.
Right. Quickly.
And the volumes are actually, you know, significant. Obviously.
Okay, let's try to get another 4 or 5 minutes here, and then we'll have to continue. So, obviously, design review will probably give us some more comments on building design and landscaping. Signage, they'll probably give you some comments on that. Let's just wait to that. Beta, do you have anything else that we need to really worry about?
The lighting and the stormwater are the two things we had commented on, and certainly you're still handling the lighting, and so I think the stormwater was adequately addressed.
Okay, so basically, at this point, you're all set?
We were comfortable, yes.
Okay, and we got design review board recommendations, which is kind of coming up. Mechanical and equipment screening, I think you talked a little bit about that. Why don't you go through that again?
The bulk of the mechanical equipment for the building will be rooftop equipment. I think we're going to see the three-dimensional model. This trough essentially in the center of the building, the roof. So the roof comes up about 5 feet higher than it needs to and creates this trough to bulk of the mechanical equipment. Each one of the domes will have two mechanical units, an inflation unit and a heating unit that'll be just outside of it.
So they're
at grade level.
So they're down along.
They're down again because we're 10 feet down. We're 12 feet down on the level, so we're somewhere between 10 and 12 feet down from grade to the dome structures. So those won't be visible from the street.
Okay, and they're located next to the building or on the far side of the court?
On the outside perimeter of the site. So they're on the outside of the bubbles, if you will. Mm-hmm.
So actually, they're shown on your site plan.
Give you an idea. So each one will have its own. There's a set of two for that bubble, and there's a set of two for that bubble right there. So you wouldn't be able to see those at all unless you were behind here doing maintenance or something. Mm-hmm.
Or if the bubble is down, I guess you're looking at one side of it, but
correct. That's right.
I don't know any way you could screen or do anything other than.
Right, these obviously have to have direct input into the dome structure to keep it inflated, so that would be tough to screen.
So that rooftop is not really a peak. If you look at it, there's a trough.
Yes. Yeah, there's is more accurate.
It's on the ground, yes. You know.
They started before we did, and obviously did a tremendous amount of work.
Okay. Let's try to get through some of these last couple issues here. Mechanical equipment and screening where everyone's comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
How about snow storage?
We did show the viable areas for snow storage on the site. We didn't see any comments back from Beta. Hopefully everybody's in agreement that we think we have enough and good areas selected.
Yeah, we had asked them to show it after the first review and they had accommodated some spaces. One of our comments was making sure their landscaping didn't overlap with the snow storage. I think they still do have some low shrubs shown in some of the storage areas, but no, I don't know that that's significant a concern.
Is the business seasonal, meaning more people are going to the pool in the summertime or the wintertime, or is it membership is kind of year-round?
It's kind of year-round. There are days, the first hot day that, Memorial Day can be a busy day. Labor Day can be a busy day, but it's generally pretty evenly spaced.
Okay, so it's not like in the middle of the winter. There's less people, so you don't use up all your... Maybe this will be the place to go in the middle of the winter.
That's right.
No, we do have some nice landscaped islands, or I should say islands that aren't landscaped, just grass in the middle because of the septic system. So we have some decent-sized areas. We also have a spot over here that's substantial. So we have some interior islands that are actually very good locations for stockpiling of snow.
Lately, this board has been putting a condition on a lot of plans that if the snow gets to be excessive, it's got to go somewhere else.
Sure, I have no aversion to that.
Lumber Street capacity, I'm trying to remember why we put that wide or straight in the road. Somebody did. Maybe that person isn't here today. Well, I think we're just about to the point where we're running out of time. I think, from an action item standpoint, I think you're pretty well set. I mean, there's some action items we've talked about today. I'm hoping with a good report from Design Review, and if they make reasonable recommendations and you incorporate them in, if you agree with them, that makes the process a lot quicker. We're looking to, I think, try to finish this up at our next meeting, or next time we can have the hearing. Elaine, what day did you have for this one?
We had December 21st. Whoever's here tonight will be at the next meeting.
At 8 p.m.?
Mm-hmm.
Look for a motion to continue the public hearing till 8 p.m. Does the 21st of December work for you guys?
Sure. Just one thing, just to put it out there, Mr. Chairman. You did mention among the things that were missing was a special permit under the groundwater overlay. I don't want to belabor it this evening, but we'll send an email to Elaine. We don't think that actually applies in this case, so we'll try to wrap that up and resolve it in short order at least.
If not, work with Elaine to try to get a condition so that we can do it, approval contingent thereof. If,
okay.
You know, okay. You've got time to figure out something that
take
works.
Take care of it. Yep.
And then you've got a couple other special polls and
stuff. Right. Right.
So and get that in quick enough so that we can do that at the same hearing.
Yep.
That would be critical though, if you could hold that the 21st.
I agree. Right.
Yeah.
I agree.
And that might be time sensitive because we've got to advertise too. So.
Mm-hmm.
I guess also in that same line of thought, if we did need relief from one of the design guidelines for the lighting, whether it's the height or the other design factors, is that a waiver from design standards from the planning board? Is that something more formal?
It's a special permit from the site plan standards. So in the site plan standards, it indicates there's a special permit that you can apply for if you don't conform with light standards, and that's what should be applied for.
Okay. So it's on the special permit application as one of the check boxes?
Well, it will be after tonight, after the board amends the application.
Okay.
We just got that authority at the last town meeting. You know, when we lowered the height of the poles, we realized that one size might not fit all, and you're one of the first that's kind of proven that case.
The poles at least are fairly bright line. To the extent that your interpretation is that special permits needed for any of the variants as far as max and minimums and averages, and since you've asked us to work on it, but we don't really know where we're going, my thought is to make a very general type of application so that the door is open for relief and we can figure out from the alternative plans what type of relief rather than specify exactly what we're looking to do since you won't have had a chance to see
that's
it.
Right. It's all under the same section,
that's
so
fine.
Just include everything that might be possible.
That's fine.
Okay.
We'll do that.
So, I think we were about to make a motion. You're all set?
Yeah,
okay. 21st of December at 8 p.m. to continue the public hearing for Tennis Club.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Seeing no further discussion, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. So now,
thank you.
Okay. Let's try to knock out the rest of the stuff in about 10 minutes, if we can. If we can do it, let's see where we're at. Let's take the easy ones first. How about approve the minutes for October 9th, 2015?
So moved.
That makes it easier. Do I hear a second?
Second.
A second. Claire, what changes do we need?
I, I don't have any, what, on the minutes? I don't have anything.
You didn't have anything? Good.
No.
Okay, I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor of approving the minutes for October 19th, 2015, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed, anyone abstained, motion carries unanimous. Okay. Moving right up. Claire and I walked on Ash Street with the tree guy from Eversource. It was a very kind of informative type session. I think we got a better sense of where he is from that. I don't want to have a public hearing, you know, per se. And quite frankly, I think he's going to be more flexible to saving a lot of the, particularly the larger trees.
Yeah, he was reasonable.
That's great. So we're thinking about maybe if somebody else would like to join me on Saturday, the 21st, which is this coming Saturday. I don't know whether the guy from Eversource will show up or not, but I at least have a...
It's no life.
A sense of where his buttons are, and so would people be available Saturday morning or Saturday afternoon? Morning works a little better for me. It's supposed to be reasonable weather, but cool. It's not a snow day.
As long as it's not too early. Soccer's done for us. So,
which street you doing?
Wilson and Front, if we can. I'd say 9 o'clock.
9 is good.
At?
What?
9
at,
is good.
Yeah. At 9? What, like summer school again?
No, let's see. Where, maybe Front there. And Valentine? Or where?
Yeah, I guess there aren't too many places you can pull over, but there's probably not a lot of traffic there. You could park in there.
On Valentine, and you know, it's the first
Valentine or Coburn, whatever.
I think Valentine.
Oh, you could park up where is that Ash Street? You know, Judy Wiley's house. There's room on the side, but that's still Ash Street. That's not quite yet. Yeah, because there's room there.
Well, if you go down Ash Street, instead of turning right to go to Judy Wiley's old house, which most people don't know where that is, but okay, if you go left. Then there'll be the first right is like Valentine, I believe.
Oh, really?
And you can park on Valentine. Okay. You know, we're only going to have 3 or 4 cars, I'm sure.
And Judy was a planning board member for a long time.
Yes, she was. She was chairman 30 years ago. Ran it out of her kitchen.
And then are you going to soul. Wilson from there?
Yeah. Okay. If we get through it, you know, about 2 hours about what, you know, and then I get my 10,000 steps for the day. And
so, 11 o'clock Wilson Street-ish?
Well,
or is it 1 hour each?
I'm hoping we kind of, we will take one car and maybe spot it so that we can do this very more efficiently.
It took a long time.
Because we walked down and back. The sidewalk is great to walk on, though.
Nice.
It was a long
anyway.
Walk.
We'll try to get both done. If not, we'll get Front Street done. And Elaine, you can post it so that people that might be interested in coming along with us. Okay. Let's see. Let's do the modification to special permit application and fees. I think we need to vote, basically, explain it.
It just adds another category of other, those two minor special permits that were adopted at the last town meeting. And then the other is the fee for that, which would be $300, and then $1,000 for consulting fees if it's needed. And if it's submitted with another application for site plan review or something, our fees are not cumulative, so just be the highest of all the fees. They don't add them up.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then for submission requirements, just do basic information.
Okay. Anyone have any questions, comments on that? Look for a motion to approve the modification to special permit application and fees.
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. Seeing no further discussion, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay. We have an A&R plan. Two sheets or one sheet?
One sheet.
One sheet.
So Front Street and South Mill, that's basically the last of the Brame land, so the east side of the road, dividing it up into five lots, five house lots. They all conform to zoning.
What's with the conservation restriction easement?
It's something with Halt, I believe, a separate...
Okay.
It's a good thing. But I'm not sure. I didn't investigate that. Something that already exists.
So, excuse me, Elena, are there already homes on this side of the street? I know, well, there are on the corner, and I know there's homes here, but I don't see them on this map. So these lots aren't changing.
Yeah, there's nothing here.
Just these little lots.
Yeah, and these are the two old homes that are at the corner.
Okay.
Farmhouses.
Mm-hmm.
And what does this mean? I want to know where these are. Just land that is.
It's part of these lots. So these little pieces snake around.
Oh, wow!
Interesting.
Creative. Oh. So it's this stretch of woods.
I wonder if it was for septic systems or something crazy. I don't know.
So it's a big swath of South Mill.
One, two, three, four, five.
But it goes all the way up to Cranberry Lane.
Yep, it's...
So is that part of Dobson's old house?
It's part of what?
Dobson's old house?
Can you just hold on to it?
I mean, is there... There's nothing being torn down or anything. Where's the pond?
Pond?
No, that's Front Street. Front Street. It's pond is way down this way. Way further.
Yes, further down.
Street's there, and Cranberry Lane's there. I thought Blood's Pond's like right around here.
No, I think it's beyond.
It's on the opposite side.
Maybe Cranberry Lane comes first.
Then Blood's Pond.
Okay, all right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Look for a motion to sign the A&R.
So moved.
Second. Move and second. Further discussion, seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carried. We'll sign it on the way out. We need two people. Okay. Master plan update. This is just if somebody hasn't worked on theirs, get working on it. I think, John, you're done. Claire, you're done. I'm done.
Next meeting? Carve out some time. Yeah. I mean, I went through
the... You won't get the next meeting.
That's right. Okay. I mean, I didn't see any wordsmithing for the transportation goals. I thought, of the four goals, they were adequate. I thought maybe just, throwing in some of the more recent activities with improvements to the, I think sidewalks are mentioned in the transportation section too.
Okay. Well, let's talk about that in detail sometime other than at 10 o'clock.
And if there's anything that you think is missing, just let me know.
Okay. Correspondence, I think we just saw something from our Board of Appeals.
A notice.
I'm going to get to Deerfield Estates last. For board members' comments and liaison reports, I will report that Pulte has submitted the north side, and we will be holding a hearing probably in January. What I'd like to think about doing is having Elaine send the plans as submitted to every one of the board members. This is a huge... 400 unit type stuff. There might there might be some generic questions that when you review it, that maybe we discuss before we get into the weeds of site plan review, such as, does the plan make sense with this number of, I won't say single family, but what's our duplex and what's simplex. You know, simplex takes more land because you got another 20 feet in between each type of house. Well, after you look at the plan, you know, maybe when the master plan special permit was done, we had a lot of townhouses, and, you know, it certainly changes the, I'll say, the look of it. I'm not saying good or bad. Or one of my questions might be is, do we, the planning board, like the neighborhood of 20 duplexes with first floor bedrooms all in a row, and even though they have a little different dormer here and a little thing there, they look all the same because they're the same kind of model. Maybe slightly different color, whatever. You know, maybe, and I think that's how they're proposed. Maybe they mix, and they're selling well, and there was reasons why they like to do that, but maybe from making it look better, maybe you need to mix and match a little bit. But I'm just saying these are the type of thinking that we ought to really say, particularly when this is, you know, huge. This is not like a 20-unit subdivision. This is big. And so I want you all to kind of think outside the plan, outside the box, and say, hey, you know, Elaine mentioned, you know, maybe we want to hire a landscape people like Sistaki that worked on it 12 years ago or whenever it was to come back and look at it and offer comments and things. You know, so really be kind of creative. And, you know,
to make it the best it could be.
This is, you know, think about it as this is going to be not quite 10% of our housing stock, but 7-8% of it. You know, wow, you know. And
another reason that the town used to have that development look was because you sold up individual lots and people put up individual homes, and you didn't have that look of a development. And the way Pulte's work, you can pick the Carolina, the Hawthorne, or the Swarthmore, you know, mix, and that's about it. Unless, you know, maybe they could have, I know there's efficiency, cost efficiencies in repetition in mass production, but, you know, maybe they could have a much larger palette of styles to choose from, so that, you know.
I think we get new styles with this. That's
yeah,
the thing.
Yeah, styles with new names.
New names. With the same.
Swarthmore 1, the Hawthorne 3.
French names.
French names.
French names.
Yeah.
Yeah. French names, I noticed.
Oh, okay.
Cabernet.
Some wine, I think.
Mm. Oh, jeez.
Oh, good.
The Cabernet.
Well, anyway, please think outside the box on that, and we'll see where we're at. Anyone else have any liaison stuff? And then we'll talk about Deerfield State for another 5-10 minutes, and we'll get out of here. Let's Claire, do you want to start the discussion on Deerfield Estates?
Sure. I will try to be brief, but up on Lumber Street is Deerfield Estates. It's an old Capital Group project. There's a historic house right by the road, McFarland Sanger House. It's probably one of the oldest houses in Hopkinton, into the 1700s. And it's a very long, involved, ugly story about how the town wound up with this house. Suffice it to say, they were going to include it in the development, and then it didn't have the right characteristics to turn into an over 55, because it's got like stone fireplaces and, you know, huge beams and stuff. And by then they had removed all of the services and carved out this little tiny lot, and it was either tear it down or just give it to the town so it'd be saved. So Capital agreed to give it to the town. We've had it for about 10 years. It's been sitting there. Right now, there's a project underway with CPC funds to do some basic structural stabilization work on the house, and then the long-term disposition, we need to find whether it's a curatorship stewardship program or find a way to turn it back to private ownership. I don't know. But in any case, Capital has been real slow in getting their work done. For the longest time, it was sitting on the top of a rock pile. And now that they've sort of finished, they really haven't, not only haven't finished what they were supposed to do to the McFarland house, but they've created kind of a problem that makes the house almost unsafe or unlivable. Here's just a couple pictures. This is the very nice landscaping plan that was supposed to happen, and you can compare it to the landscaping that does not exist. See all those nice trees? You see any of them there? We can pass. So that's one thing that they've done. And the other, more concerning, is they carved out a very small lot, and I can pass copies of the lot plan around.
This wall is right here, where all the trees were.
And it was a small small lot to begin with, but what they've basically done is a corner of this lot, it looks like there's a stone wall that comes along the edge, but what you don't realize is that upper corner is hanging in the air. The stone wall is a 20-foot cliff, and what we end up getting is we have a back door with a stoop that goes off a 20-foot cliff with no barrier. On the other corner, there's about a 4-foot piece of land, and then it falls off a cliff. The rest of our lot, I think, is out in space somewhere. Mm-hmm. On another corner, there's about less than 2 feet of land, and you literally fall off a cliff. Here's a picture of the bulkhead, where you also fall off a cliff. We are working to have some of this work done. North Bennett Street School, which is a preservation architecture school out of Boston, is probably going to come do a lot of the work, as well as Keefe Tech, so we may be having students come on this land. And they've basically created a house where if you come out the door, you fall off a cliff. And what was supposed to be yard on this plan, looked like it was a piece of a yard, is actually in the air. So the question is, you know, what can we do? How can we put pressure on Deerfield?
Well, one of the things I think the board could do is to ask the building inspector whether or not a fence needs to be...
Well, a fence is the very least.
Installed just to meet building code.
Yeah, I mean, that's unacceptable. I mean, that is just...
And it scares me to think we're going to have people working on that. In terms of moving the project forward, how could you ever find anyone who even wanted to live or use that house when, you know, they didn't show in this plan that this lot included going off the cliff into space. We just assumed this was
grass. The plan, the color rendering of it.
The landscape hasn't happened.
You know, I think, and Elaine, you've been trying to get them to...
I did actually hear from Bill DiPietri today. And they dropped off a utility as-built plan. So we have an as-built plan, and I indicated to him that we'd like to have a walkthrough with the plan. So he's agreeable to that. So if we could set up a date and some people who want to do a walkthrough, and with Historical Commission or others, we can walk through the project.
Well, what if they walk? The issue is not that what's inside the house.
Well, they believe
it's what
they're
done.
On
the outside.
But there's still landscaping and other things.
We hold about
a
90-something thousand-dollar bond, so that
you can point out what's supposed to be done.
I mean, I understand how anyone in their right mind, a developer, would possibly think that you can create a house lot with like less than 2 feet of land on one side, and then it falls off a 20-foot cliff.
He believes that it was done per the plan. This is what he said. So I think what needs to happen is people to actually go out there in person and point to it.
Well, I think, you know, we gather up all the stuff to kind of show that at least the landscaping stuff doesn't. Because, I mean, if he thinks he's done, then he's going to be asking for money back, and we've got to be ready to do that.
And from that landscaping plan, you can see there's supposed to be extensive landscaping, so that when you looked at the house, you saw a barrier of green behind, and there was some kind of a nice setting. And conversely, the people at Deerfield have partly been complaining about the house because it's deteriorating. They weren't supposed to see a house. I mean, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to look at that picture and then look at the photograph and know what you did.
Okay, so we have a plan. Are we going to, and part of that plan is to ask the building inspector whether or not railings of some sort or
as far as the fence goes. But ideally, it would be nice to have a different grade there.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, if you look at this here, that corner is in the air, because this is the stone wall that comes along, and out here, there's no land at all.
Well, I just don't know what this little dashed line. That looks to me like it's an old cart road or something. I don't know what that is on that plan.
I think I saw another plan where it called that out a stone wall.
Okay.
So, but we didn't expect that the stone wall was going to be that enormous retaining wall of boulders with 20 feet drop.
Okay.
So, well, I don't know. I would think, Elaine, within the building inspector, that there are certain parameters that you have to meet for a house lot to be considered.
Well, I'm not sure this Dempsey is not considered a house lot.
Well, it's a building that
it's a non-conforming lot
intended to be a
historic preservation.
Right. But again, you've created a tremendous public hazard if you create a lot that falls off a cliff.
Sure.
Right, it wasn't supposed to be.
I mean, it was supposed to be for some kind
of community. Nobody approved it thinking it was like that. Yeah. Last thing I wanted to mention is the CPC committee is going through all the submittals. There's one that maybe some help could be. There's a Parks and Rec request to take the playground on EMC Field. This is the little kids' playground, and completely scrap it. There's a couple broken pieces to it, and spend $125,000 of CPC to build a whole brand new, similar type playground. And if people wanted to drive in there and look at it, I'm not sure whether it's maintenance, and they should just spend the $10,000-$15,000, which comes kind of out of their budget. Under CPC, we can't use money for maintenance, but if they tore it all down, we could use it. But I am just not sure. It's 18 years old, and they say it's, it's seen its life. I don't know what lifespan is in that, but I thought that you could replace pieces of a structure.
I thought they had added pieces over time, and not all of it was.
There might be, and maybe if you got a wing, you know, but. They're looking at it as CPC is just one big, you know, and this recreation money comes out of either the land purchase or other big recreation for, say, you know, fields at Legacy or fields at Fruit Street or stuff like that. So, I mean, it's $125,000. I mean, as a grandfather who has used that with my grandkids, yeah, I noticed that the stuff is, some of it is broken. And that I don't like, but I don't know how to react on the solution. Toss it all out, or just find the money and somewhere to fix it as opposed to whatever. But so if anyone drove by there, drive in and take a good look at that.
And, got it.
Okay.
Can I just ask one question on Deerfield? We do have a performance bond, but are we limited in, I mean, that performance bond is for certain things, like this much for roadway, this much for, you know, infrastructure things. That's just not a hunk of money that we could take and use for something else, is it?
Well, I mean, if the landscaping wasn't done.
Landscaping you probably could.
Yes.
But other things like to reconfigure the retaining wall and put some fill in to create a safe, you know, side yard instead of a 20-foot cliff.
Possible.
It's possible.
But depends on how close it fits to what the board plan, you know, if you can show that the as-built is significantly different with what the board approved, and that's, I think, predates most of us.
Well, I'd be interested to see a grading plan to see if it showed that there was a 20-foot drop-off.
That would be part
the corner of the house.
That would be part of the due diligence on our part to kind of try to prove our point. If it didn't show that, then yeah.
It seems to show the trees were planned and maybe never planted.
You couldn't even plant trees here. Yeah. No soil.
It's clear that
I think the grading plan is probably different than this is what was built.
Well, I'm just reminded by the construction guy at Pulte that said it never looks as good as the landscaping plan.
No.
Yeah, but a cliff.
A
couple pages of this.
So,
I'm sorry, I need to head out.
Yep. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Thank you.